like clowns coming out of a little car. They just, y'all just kept coming out from behind there.
Amen. Turn with me, if you will, the book of Matthew, chapter number 5. Matthew, chapter number 5. It's a nice little crowd tonight. It's on Wednesday. I'll try to be mindful of the time so that you come back next week. Amen. Turn the sound off this thing. If there's anything that gets on the way nowadays, it's technology, and you never notice it till you're in front of a bunch of people. Matthew chapter number 5. I want to take a look at some things in the next couple of weeks Matthew and spend probably the rest of the summer in here, if you're okay with it. I know we just left a book study, but now we're just going to study one sermon. It's just one sermon, guys. Just one whole sermon. And I don't know how long it'll take me, but I want to spend some time on it because Jesus thought it was important for us to know, so we might as well learn it, right? And I realize and recognize that if you were here 5 years ago, I've preached a series on the Sermon on the Mount, but I'm a lot more mature now. It's a lot different. I'll be honest, I read this the other day when the Lord laid this on my heart for the first time in a minute, and everything just jumped out differently to me, and I'm just going to give you what He gives me. I'm not going to try to philosophize it. There you go. So that's all I can come up with at the time. I'm just going to give you exactly how He lays it out to me, and we'll go with that. We see in verse number 1 through verse number 12 is where we're going to be tonight. We find that a gathering of people accumulate at Jesus. They find themselves enamored by who He is. And so they gather together for many different reasons. And it's just like a normal church service. People gather for different reasons. If I were to interview every individual in the room tonight, we'd all have a different perspective on why we're here. Most of us should answer the question, I want to get close, by saying I want to be closer to God than I was yesterday. That's why I'm here. But many people are here for other reasons. Amen. People come to church to find a husband or a wife. Did you know that? Amen. It's not a bad place to look. Amen. You get a lot better results. I would hope that you would get a lot better results. So we find these that there are some there to criticize. There are some there to see miracles, and there's some there because they're the disciples. They are true followers of Jesus Christ. And I wonder tonight, what are you here for? Are you here for a miracle? You just see something that you've never seen before, to be a part of some kind of this big wow moment? Are you here because you want to be critical? Oh, that was a good spot to stop on, wasn't it? Amen. You want to be critical. You want to analyze and overanalyze and figure out reasons why not to be a believer of Christ Jesus. And why everyone in the church is a bunch of broken people. May I say to you, the reason why you're here tonight is not because you're perfect. It's because Jesus Christ is perfect. Amen. Everybody's broken today, but has been on the mend since they found the men's maker. Amen. And so we find that He opens His mouth, the Bible says, and taught. I like how it puts that. You know, He just opened His mouth, started preaching. Sets down. Isn't that weird? In Bible times, the preacher sets down and everybody else stands up. You want to go on a switch? Because I could go, you know, I could go a lot longer sitting down than I can standing up, amen? And then y'all's legs would be quivering and all that stuff. But this wasn't like anything they'd ever heard before. The words that Jesus spoke more like a manifesto than just a good old synagogue sermon. It was something that was a little bit more than they expected. You see, because the people in attendance that day were Jews who were looking for Am I dead? Am I on? I'm on. Yeah, man. See, there's only two places you can be in West Virginia, over yonder and right here. Amen? Those in attendance were longing for a Messiah. And so they were looking for this king who would squash the enemy, who would reign supreme and set them free from all captivity. They were looking for something. So when this Jesus would stand or would begin to speak and they would hear about this kingdom, they would hear something a little bit different than what they were expecting. They were expecting some vast change and vast approach to what a kingdom should look like, but yet there is Jesus who's, he's about to roll up his sleeves and punch people right in the face, but it ain't going to be the enemy. he deals with the kingdom, and he doesn't sound like a ideological philosopher or any scribe that they would know. He is simply one who stands with authority, without apology, without any meekness any fear in his voice. He stands with authority. In fact, in verse number 28 and 29 of Matthew 7, it says this, and it came to pass when Jesus had ended these sayings, the people were astonished at his doctrine. For he taught them as one having authority, not as a scribe. You see, to be a part of the kingdom of God, you must recognize the authority of Jesus Christ. Who is he? He is King incarnate. He is God with us. He is everything that we need. But he's hard to recognize to these people on the hillside. Because when he draws their attention to the kingdom, they had my kingdom in mind and not thy kingdom. And I wonder today, when you walk through this door and you had an idea of what the kingdom of God is like, does it look more like what you think it should look like and not enough about what he thinks it should look like? I wonder if there's somebody in here who's building their kingdom and not his kingdom. So over the next couple of weeks, I want to take a look at this idea, thy kingdom come. Not my kingdom, his kingdom. Listen, let me say it again. Not my kingdom, his kingdom. If we change the way that we live and approach life, not to be about us and about ours and about our philosophies and our ideas, and we start shaping and... Lord God, just hit me. If we start shaping ourselves in the truth of Jesus, in the gospel, and letting it set us free, and taking the grace of God one day at a time, we can see the true kingdom life. I want to live a kingdom life. But I don't want my kingdom. Thy kingdom. And let it come. Because my king never fell off a Huffy bike. Amen? If you don't mind standing for the reading of God's word as we look at verse number 1 of Matthew chapter number 5. We see that the Bible says this, and seeing the multitude, he went up into the mountain, and when he was set, his disciples came unto him. And he opened his mouth, and he taught them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the kingdom of inherit the earth." Now let me go King James on you. Blessed are the are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are ye when men shall revile you and persecute you and shall say all manners of evil against you falsely for my name's sake, or for my sake. Rejoice and be exceedingly glad. For great is your reward. Where?
In heaven.
How'd that make you feel? All right. For so persecuted they the prophets which were before you. Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for being so good to us. Lord, we ask you, God, that you would meet with us tonight. I pray, God, that you would take your word and begin to move and impress upon our hearts and change who we are, that we would not seek after my kingdom, after our kingdom, but Lord, thy kingdom. Let it come on earth as it is in heaven. God, I pray that you'd pour out your spirit, move in a mighty way. Lord, I pray that you'd set us on fire tonight. Change who we are to who you want us to be. God, empty me of self and sin. Fill me, Lord Jesus, with your spirit, because today it is the Super Bowl, and I pray, God, that together, Lord, we leave no doubt. For it's in your name, Jesus, we pray. Amen, and you may be seated. This sermon is one of those sermons, or this section of Scripture is one of those sections of Scripture that is often referred to as the Beatitudes. How many people has heard of the Beatitudes?
Right.
I don't understand why they call it the Beatitudes. I don't know. Maybe because you're supposed to be that way. Amen? Be this attitude. All right? I don't know. I don't know why they came up with that. If we call it anything, we should call it the blessed attitudes. Amen. Blessed, or blessed if you are living in the old days. Amen. I don't know why they say blessed. It's spelled blessed, right? If Titus read that, he'd say blessed, because that's just how they teach them. But we say blessed, and blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Amen. The word blessed introduces each beatitude. It is translated from the word, which literally means happy. Wow. Does that change how you read it? Let me read it again. Happy are the poor. Happy are they that mourn. Happy are the meek. Happy are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness. Happy are the merciful. Happy are they are the pure of heart. Happy are the peacemakers. Happy are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake. Happy are ye. Happy, 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 happy. Yeah.
You knew where I was going. Happy. Here the Lord gives us a recipe for a happy life, a happy death, and a happy eternity. In other words, the kingdom, a kingdom person or kingdom people are a happy people because they are a blessed people. Whereas they may have obstacles, they may have struggles, they may have pain, but it does not change the fact that they are blessed. If there's anything I can tell you about being a Christian, it is that you will feel pain. It is that you will have problems. It is that you will go through some situation. You will have strife in your life. You will experience some things. But I promise you this, you will be blessed all the way through it. You see, if you noticed, all of the struggles and all of those pains are attached to the world. Have you ever noticed? All of your pain is attached to the world. Did you know this? And I get to be the person to bear this record to you today. That one day, you won't be in this world no more. And the only thing that you will possess is those things that are eternal. So the possessions that you, let me say this. So the possessions that you have down here, you can't take them with you. You can't, listen, Pharaoh, you can't put it in your tomb and take it with you. It don't matter what kind of cat you got and want to take with you. Sorry, I was reading something the other day, and why in the world would you entomb a cat? That's just weird. Those people were crazy. Sorry. You see, if you notice that Jesus always attaches some type of eternal to what is a temporal. We are not temporarily blessed people. We are eternally blessed people. But we struggle in seeing that because of our perspective. Because we have grown to see things with a worldly lens. There was a man who went to one of those, it must have been in Pennsylvania or New Jersey or something like that, because it still had people who do stuff for you. And now in West Virginia, you do it yourself. Amen. But they went to a gas station, and the guy come up to clean the window. It's New Jersey. I knew it was something there. Yeah, it's up that way. And so he goes up there, and the guy cleans his window, and he rolls his window down and said, "Sir, that's just as dirty as whenever you started. Do it again." Yes, New Jersey. Yeah. And they cleaned it up. Anybody from New Jersey in here? Good. Nobody. So they clean it again. The guy rolls his window down and gets huffy with the man. He says, "Clean it again. It's just as dirty." I mean, he's all flabbergasted, angry. His wife looks at him, looks at the window, looks at him again, reaches over and grabs his glasses and cleans them off and hands them back to him. You see, you only see from this perspective that is closest to you. So if your glasses are dirty, there's a chance that your window is dirty. Amen? Hold on. If everything is wrong and messed up in your world, you probably are the problem. If you are messed up by every little situation in life, it's probably because you are spending so much time focusing on every little problem in life. Sorry, I didn't mean to get all up in your grill tonight. But these kingdom people are people who look ahead to the kingdom and understand that life down here is temporary. So he answers some questions about what it would be like to be a kingdom person, a person who has a kingdom perspective. And he looks first and foremost at what we are. What we are. Jesus deals firstly with what we are because what we are is more important than what we do. Let me say that again. Write this down. What we are is more important than what we do. Preacher, but James says you got to be a doer of the word and not a hearer only. I know, I recognize that. And he's right. He's right. I'm not getting on to the Lord's brother. Amen. I'm not going to do it. I know my place. I'm saying this, that we are different. We are. We are different. So he begins first and foremost with the poor in spirit. He says, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. The word poor indicates someone who is reduced to beggary. When we add that in light of the word spirit, we find out that this is a person who is humbled. And I wonder today, are you a humble person? Wow. I'll keep going. He moves on to those that are pressed in the soul. Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. Those that have looked on their sins and the sins that surround them, and it breaks them down. They mourn after. It's hard for me in our generation to see a group of people in general at our society, a Christian nation, in the state that it is. Because we allow ourselves not only to live with sin, but also to live in sin. We do. You see, if we truly had this perspective of the true authority of God in His kingdom, it would change our perspective to sin. Let me say it again. If we truly had a perspective of God and His kingdom on earth and in heaven and eternal, we would change our perspective on sin. We would not allow everybody's opinion to become the gospel truth. He said, preacher, prove it to me. Jason, I know you're busy back there. Can you pull up Isaiah chapter 6 for me? I'm going to read you something. It may look like I'm quoting, but I'm reading off that backboard back there. I ain't nearly this smart. Isaiah chapter number 6, we find that King Uzziah, he dies, and it makes an impact on Isaiah. And so I just picture him, he's walking around the kingdom. And as he's walking around the kingdom, he's thinking about how the king is dead, the king is dead. And you know, when you place all of your beliefs behind a man, behind a earthly kingdom, when that man is no longer in office, it will make you jump a fence and run places you ain't supposed to go. Amen? You ain't supposed to say. I'm just observant, okay? When you place all of your importance upon a certain man, you will do certain things for that man that you should not do, for that government system. So here he is. This man has died. He died. So he's at a loss, and he's looking for a king to because his king's dead. The Bible says, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up. His train filled the temple. Now he said this, it stood above the seraphims. Each one with six wings, and twain he did cover his face, and with twain he did cover his feet, and with twain he did fly. And one cried to one cried unto another and said, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God, the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. And the posts of the door moved at the voice of him that cried out, and the house was filled with smoke. Now look at verse 5. He has seen God high and lifted up. The glory cloud has encompassed him in the midst of the temple, and he feels the presence of God. And look at what he says next. Whoa! He's seen God in... the glory of God shining around. He's seen who God was, and he said, I am undone because I am a man of unclean lips. He said, I have sin inside of me. I am a sinner by nature. He's seen God and said he had sin. Nobody told him that he had sin. He never had a preacher tell him about his sin. He never, Lord help me tonight. He never had a person come by and hand him a gospel tract. He just heard about him. He just seen God and said, I see that God is great, that God is good, that God is wonderful, and he abides in us all and for us all and above us all. And when I look at God, all I see is that this magnificent being, and I am little and I am a sinner. And not only is it me, but he said, I dwell in the midst of people with unclean lips. He said, I've seen the King, the Lord of hosts. Wow. And I don't understand how Christians can say, I believe Jesus Christ is my Savior. I believe that he died on the cross for my sin, and allow themselves to live a sinful life. Oh, help me. I don't see how Christians will allow themselves to look on the smut that we dwell in today and not feel a little bit uncomfortable. Do you know this? This is just free. The FDA is getting ready to outlaw e-cigarettes. I just made everybody in here go, oh, Lord, help me. And we don't show, listen, we don't show Marlboro on TV anymore, do we? Winston? We can't even have a Winston cup anymore. We got to call it this, whatever. What is it? The NASCARs, they ain't even Sprint cup anymore. Man, I don't even know if Sprint's a thing. But, Brother Chris, think about this. It's wrong for us to put a pack of cigarettes on the back of a Sports Illustrated. But yet, Jim Beam can be plastered all over your TV. But we can allow Budweiser to take the Clydesdale because they're cute and walk them down the street, up and down, film that thing, put it on the Super Bowl ad 17 times so that kids can see that. I know that cancer is bad, But I'm going to say this, and you can get mad at me if you want to, but I've seen a lot of sick people who's laying on the side of the road with a Bud Light in their hand, with a Jim Beam and Jack Daniels recipe in their hand, and every one of them are struggling, and yet we still produce that and promote that. Why? Because the world wants you to stay drunk to it. The world wants to keep you down. But listen, I'm here to say this. Look at Jesus. See who He is, and He'll change who you are. We've got problems in our generation right now. We're so focused on all the junk in our society that we can't see what they're doing in our families. I don't think I'm going to finish tonight, but I'm all right with it. I'm going to stay right here for a minute. I got parents in the room. Y'all need to listen. Your home is under attack. What you possess in your life is a load of potential in those children. And what we allow them to see and experience will be what makes them who they are. So don't get mad at the preacher when he talks about running around here and there and everywhere and placing importance upon things that are temporary. Trust me, I got a lot of $5 trophies at home with little baseball figures on them, little football figures and all that stuff. They're sitting at home with dust on them. Half of them broken, their heads off, or the bat's missing. I have little short memories. But I remember being 18 years old, walking in the back of the church in a ball uniform with dirt from here to here. My mom laying a towel over top of the pew that I was going to sit in and me sitting there. I remember those. And I remember being dog tired from catching two games. That's probably why my knees are jacked up. In the middle of summer. You can chase a ball all you want to. But eternity, if nobody's told you, lasts forever. The trophies will fall. They'll fade. The medals will rust. But the relationship that you allow your children to experience with Christ will be eternal. So where are we going with it? So we in this generation need to recognize what we are is more important than what we do. He says, lastly, I'm done on this one, all right? I'm done. This is my first point. I wish I had known I was going to do this. I wouldn't have stressed about all the other stuff. The poor in spirit, the oppressed in the soul, and lastly, patience and strife. He says this, blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. I want to say this for all my friends in the room. It says meek, not weak. Say it again. It says meek, not weak. Weak says you can come into my house and do whatever you want. Amen? Meek meets them at the door, finds out what they want, views it, and takes a stand. Let me say it again. Meek logs on to Disney Plus, sits down and watches Buzz Lightyear to see if the Facebook rumor is true, and then meek takes a stand. Did you hear me? You preacher, you don't preach like this. I've never heard you preach like this. Well, Lord, I need to. We have a lot of things indoctrinating our families. And it's coming through their eyes and their ears. So instead of being weak, let's be meek. Be meek. Just have some patience about us. And instead of just saying, I just turn it on. Here's YouTube. Go over there. I'm cleaning. I'm washing the dishes. I'm mopping the floor. I'm folding the laundry. I got to cut the grass right now. Yeah. And not see what's going into them. Let me ask you this question. If you knew it was poison, would you feed it to your children? When we examine ourselves to the truth of what we are, do we need to be poor in spirit? Do we need to look at our sins a little bit differently than what we're doing? And do we need to be patient? Take some time, investigate, and take a stand. I think we do. Why? Because I love my family. I love my friends. I love my church. And I want to be a kingdom man. That's it. Because I'm blessed. I wonder tonight, are you blessed? Blessed enough to be humbled. Amen. I'm blessed enough to mourn. And I'm blessed enough to be meek. Every head bowed and every eye closed. Nobody looking around. Lord, I don't even know where half of this stuff come from tonight. I had a lot of different things written down. But I want to ask you this. Are you a part of the kingdom of God? Have you recognized God, Jesus, as authority in your life? Have you allowed Him to save you? Now are you allowing Him to direct you? If you're here tonight and you say this, I want to raise my hand and give testimony to the fact that if Jesus comes or I should die, I'm ready to meet Him. I know I'm saved. Here's my hand. I'm going to ask a different question tonight. One I've never asked before. Preacher, I want to raise my hand in testimony and say, I'm letting Jesus drive my ship. Here's my hand.
Just as I am.
I wonder tonight if you're here and you say this, preacher, I don't know if I've ever been saved and I don't know who's driving today, but I sure would like to have somebody in control of it more than me. Here's my hand. Will you pray for me? I can give my heart to Jesus. Here's my hand. Maybe you're here today and you say this, preacher, will you pray for me? That I could be a little more humble in my life. Here's my hand. Yeah. Maybe you're here today and you say this, preacher, will you pray for me? That I could stop allowing the sins of this world to be my sins and affect my life. Here's my hand. Preacher, will you pray for me? That I could be the man or woman that I need to be. And patience. Examine the world. Get set free. Examine my whole. Keep the devil out. Keep the world out. Here's my hand. Will you pray? Amen. Praise God. I wonder tonight, we've got so many people that raise their hand. We've already got one. I'm here praying. I wonder. And I promise I'm going to pray for you. I wonder if you step out of your seat, come down to this altar, and call on God and recognize His authority in your life and say, Jesus, I need you. Not a man, not a system, not a government. I need you today. Help me. I recognize who you are, and I'm calling on your name. These have come. How about you? Help me to be humble. Help me to be patient. Lord, help me not not to get comfortable in the sins that I'm surrounded by. Thank you for this day. Thank you for the church service that we've had. It's kind of different. Lord, I didn't see you doing this. And God, I'm thankful that you did. I pray, God, that you would give us perspective today. God, we just start taking a stand in our life. Because if we don't, God, what's the world going to be like? What's our home going to be like? What's all these kids' teenage years going to look like, God? What's it all going to be like if we don't start now? God, you've blessed us. Let us not take for granted what you've done. Don't let our eyes gloss over tonight to what you're doing and what you will do. Let us have clear eyes.
Yes.
See the future in front of us. We walk hand in hand with you. It's your kingdom, not ours. We love you in Jesus'
name.
Yes,
that's right.
Amen. All right. Hope you enjoyed coming to church tonight. Look at me. I'm 5 minutes earlier than normal. What we'll do is we're going to close out church service tonight. If you need to talk to me, I'll be up here on the stage. I love you. Have a good night.
Amen.